Well, good evening, everyone. Let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council work session for this evening, November 5th, 2018. We'll start with item A, which is our comments and questions, and then audience, we need to move into an executive session right after this, so we'll have a bit of a breather. So yes, Council President.
I actually want to real quickly get some consensus from the council. Councilmember Ross has a quick announcement she wants to make about something happened in the community, but she wants to do that before we end the meeting because she's afraid there may be people that are not here at 10 o'clock that are here now because we're anticipated to go for a little while. So I'm sorry with the council if she makes that quick announcement.
I just want to clarify the information on the public art ribbon cutting that we're going to have for another one of our signal box art wraps. And it is on the 10th, and it's at 10:30. I wasn't sure if it was 10 o'clock or 10:30. But it's going to be really great. This is art by the kids, for the kids. And I just sent everybody the invitation, and everybody should come. Thank you.
All right.
That's it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So item A, any comments or questions on our memo items this evening? We're all good? Who's here? Chief, how long do you want in exec session? Start with 10. All right, so we're moving into an executive session. This is our police department labor negotiation briefing, and I think I'll start with 10 minutes and come back out if we need a few more minutes. All right, so let's. All right, council's reconvened, so we'll move on to item C. This is the Ground Emergency Medical Transportation, GEMT, and draft districting plan for our RFA. I think Sonia's coming to the table, as well as Bob Eastman.
Yep.
It's been a while.
It has.
Welcome back.
Almost just over a year, right?
Yeah.
So did you want to start?
I can start, sure.
I want to pull it closer.
So the you're all familiar with the Ground Emergency Medical Transport, GEMT, the rebate or the refund we can get back. So Bob Eastman has been really involved with this effort as part of the RFA's participation in this. He is very knowledgeable about GEMT. I did have a presentation to the Council Finance Committee last month about what's going on with GEMT, but if there's hard questions, I wanted Bob Eastman to be here to summarize what's going on and why we have to pay somebody first before we get paid, and so he can explain all that.
So real quick, where we are right now with GEMT and the settlements. The contract that was in your packet, we did anticipate getting most states that do a GEMT type program do have a contract with healthcare authority or their equivalent thereof. I didn't expect it to be 9 or 10 pages long. When we got the document, we had Rich Davis, our legal counsel, review it. And we found several things in it that actually concerned us. One is the date. What we're dealing with healthcare specifically right now is the settlements from fiscal year 16 and fiscal year 17, which have passed. The current contract says it goes back 12 months. Well, we're talking about stuff that's further back than 12 months. So Rich Davis's office has been talking with healthcare, who then in turn has been working with state contracting to update the contract that needs to be signed to fill in some of those discrepancies as far as the timeline goes. The thing to remember is this doesn't affect the city of Lynnwood, but this is only for the IGT and the contract and their intergovernmental transfers only for the last two quarters of fiscal year 17. And then for the city of Lynnwood would be the first quarter of fiscal year 18. after that, the third and fourth quarters for fiscal year 18 are being paid under a different mechanism, which does not require an intergovernmental transfer, doesn't require a contract. So this is specifically for the settlement for fiscal year 16 and 17, and then the first two quarters of fiscal year 18. So I had hoped that we would have a copy of the updated contract from healthcare. That has not come. I didn't get it. I talked to Rich. I drive down here at 6, and he had not received it from healthcare as of 6 o'clock tonight. I would recommend that once we get that agreement, that would be the agreement we work off of. That's what the RFA is going to do. I would recommend that that's what the city of Lynnwood also uses to contract with healthcare as we move forward with the settlement and the intergovernmental transfer to recoup the settlement. There's one more piece that we have not received from healthcare yet, which is what our share of the non-federal funds are. We're still waiting for that to come from healthcare. I would anticipate, well, I would have thought we've already had it. So that's the second piece. The contract, and that's normal, is you enter in a contract with healthcare to do the process of the intergovernmental transfer. We still need to get the documentation from healthcare that tells us what the non-federal portion is of that, which is what we then need to transfer to, through the intergovernmental transfer, to this place where it sits. Then once that's done, the state, the federal match comes in, and then the dollars come back to the participating agency. It sounds unique, but quite frankly, intergovernmental transfers, government does this a lot at the federal level. I don't think cities do it very often. Fire departments don't do it very often, but it's something that has been happening in the state of Washington since 1986. So that's kind of where it goes. Then what happens is once we send the money and the state then puts in the federal share, it then goes back down through the managed care organizations and then funnels back to would be the city or the RFA, depending on the participant. So with that, I'm going to stop and take questions if anybody has any, because sometimes this is a challenging process.
Any questions? No? You were clear as mud.
I just want to add something. It could be a substantial amount of money that we receive. What we're going to have to do is pay the state health care agency half of the amount that we're going to receive. So we are going to be needing to amend the budget for the amount that we have to, through the intergovernmental transfer, pay to the state agency in turn to get the monies that we are due. So, but we don't know what that is at this point. So before the end of the year, we'll be bringing forward a budget amendment to add the expenditures and the revenue.
Councilmember Frizzell.
But it's my understanding we have a probable estimate.
We received an estimate from the consultant, not from the state.
Okay.
President Goodwin?
When you say that we would have to pay half, does that mean if it was determined that the city was getting $300,000, we would have to pay $150,000 and then they would give us back $450,000, or they'd give us back $300,000?
They would give us back $300,000.
Okay.
Yeah, it's definitely half, exactly.
Exactly.
So, and the mayor would have to sign this intergovernmental transfer agreement in order to get the funds. So at a subsequent meeting, we will have a contract for you to let her approve in the future, let her sign, give her authority to sign that contract with the health care agency. So since this is a work session, we don't have that contract, and it's not complete yet. So in a subsequent meeting, there will be a contract for you to let the mayor approve in the future.
Okay. And lastly, I just want to say, sweet patches you have there, Chief Eastman.
Thank you. Took a long time. So what we're talking about in the intergovernmental transfer right now is for fiscal year 17. We are in the process of completing the cost report for fiscal year 18. That's due at the end of the month. Based on what the state timeline is this will be something that we will come back, I'm assuming come back again, probably the beginning of the second quarter of next year to do this. You're going to have to do another intergovernmental transfer for the first quarter of fiscal year 2018 also. So you'll have to do this twice, once for fiscal year 17 and again for the first quarter of fiscal year 18.
Councilmember Frizzell?
So just to clarify, fiscal year quarter one would be July 1st to September 30th. Doesn't run on the same calendar year.
Yeah, that's correct. We're running on the, is it the state or the federal? I think they're both the same, right?
Mm-hmm. State. So the second intergovernmental transfer will be substantially less. It's only going to be for 3 months, right, versus this one is for 12 months, the first one.
All right. Any other questions? All right. Your next topic, districting, I see.
So what's coming around is the RFA has been working on a commissioner districting plan. If you remember when we brought the initial RFA plan forward, the plan calls for five commissioner districts and then two commissioners at large. The plan also identified that the five commissioner districts would be on the ballot in 2019 for seating in 20. And for that to happen, the RFA needed to create a districting plan for those commissioners. This is what we are calling Plan 2, but it's the one that's currently being discussed with the RFA board. The plan identified, or part of the governance in the plan said that at least two of the commissioner districts needed to encompass the city of Lynnwood. This plan actually, three of the districts touch the city of Lynnwood. Commissioner District 1, 2, and 3 have portions of the city of Lynnwood within those commissioner districts. And other than that, if you in your packet was the actual plan that was drawn. We had some Amish data actually draw the commissioner districts for us. In your packet is his work. What we did for the maps that I gave you is we took his stuff within GIS, created maps that our GIS, Steve Wheeler, could actually, we could make them bigger, make them smaller, make it so you guys could actually read what was on it. Not only that, we put in street segments so you could, you can, by reference of street names, you could know what those boundaries were. In the plan, it gives you what Sammamish data gave us, gives you the population breakdown. I think we're within 1%. It also gives you the breakdown on, there's a couple other things in there. I can't remember, but not looking at ethnicity. Were the two big ones, that and population. The packet you have shows the five districts in one map, and then it shows each individual district, so you can see them larger. I've also brought 2-foot by 3-foot maps of this, and I've got a wall map that's, I think, 4-foot by 5-foot. Also for you.
Vice President Sessions?
Thank you. So just to clarify, as we thought we would for sure get two Lynnwood positions, it's possible to get three Lynnwood positions, well, or five,
yep,
if they all came from,
yep,
with the large ones.
Yep.
Okay, everybody hear that? We want five representatives on the South County Fire coming up. Get out there and file.
So this is a draft plan. We're going to talk about it tomorrow night at the RFA board meeting. And so if you have any input, please make sure that the Lynnwood representatives can bring that back to the RFA board. And we're always free to answer questions if you have any.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a kind of a question just about the formation of these districts. Who participated in the, like, was this kind of, so it sounds like an individual was contracted with the district or with the RFA to do this. So they were kind of, it's a little bit of like a double blind, like they did it outside of the bubble of input from board members or anybody else. This was purely scientific and data driven.
I'll let.
Council President.
Council.
Thank you.
Commissioner.
Yeah. I would not say that per se, but there are very specific parameters that he goes, but he actually, the gentleman that Sammamish Data Systems, he worked with the Port of Seattle, I believe it was, when they did redistricting. He's worked with a number of other state agencies, and so there are very few but very specific parameters that he has to go within, and that's what he did. And in doing so, some of the things that others have tasked him with, for instance, was to make sure that the districts, and this was in a different jurisdiction, that none of the, I think this was a city, a municipality, that none of the council members were in more than, so each council member basically had their own district, that kind of thing. So the sitting council members were each in a different district. That was not one of the parameters that we had set.
Fantastic.
So you'll see that there could be three commissioners that live in one of those districts. I don't know what it is, really. I think there are at least two that two members sit in the certain districts. But we specifically didn't want to do that because we were trying to make it as open and equitable a process as we could. So really the parameters we gave that he works with were, we wanted the population to be very similar. And most jurisdictions, he said, he's been able to defend, I think he said, like 13%. Ours is, as Chief Zuma said, less than 1%. So the population is very equal throughout each of those districts. And, I mean, if you came to the meeting tomorrow and heard a discussion about it, you would hear a lot of that same information. Those are the same concerns that each of the commissioners had as well, is to make sure that it's very open, very upfront, and we're not trying to save seats and do that kind of thing. I mean, we're making it very open because we want people to run and to get in there and do that job. So,
thank you. I appreciate that. Sitting on the RFA Consolidation Board, that was kind of one of, we wanted to make sure that this was an open process and it wasn't, there weren't, yeah, so thank you.
That addresses my concern.
I'll also address another thing that we're trying to do is get these maps up in as many of the firehouses or things as we can, and as we have open houses and different things to present that material so that it's out in the public and people can make recommendations and whatever as they see fit, if they have concerns or whatever. We're trying to get as much input as we can with that same thing. So
excellent.
Councilmember Frizzell.
I just wanted to bring attention to a table that is in our packets that shows that of the total population in the district of 163,698, how that was distributed within each of the five districts that the mapping company came up with, and that there is a variation of as many as 300, but that is less than 1% out of the whole total. And so he was working with precinct lines and boundary lines, and where does I-5 come, and where does this street come? So this was his second stab at it, after we did give him a little bit more direction, but I think he did a fabulous job in staying geographically within areas for us.
Council President?
And just one other thing. When the Sammamish Data Systems first did it, there were some pieces that kind of jutted out and made it, they were still fairly like street oriented, but it could have been very confusing. So we were trying to make it, you know, I-5 and 212, as many big streets as we could to make it so when someone gets their ballot, they know what district they're in instead of having to go to a map and see if I'm on this side street, is it in this one or this one? Sometimes it can't be helped to do that necessarily because of the way population is, but he's done a very good job of making it so the borders are quite clear in most instances. So that was another thing that we're trying to initiate there.
Councilmember Hurst?
I was trying to go from memory, so this is a little different than what we had in the plan, correct?
Yep. He never saw the plan we had from the RFA. He was not given, he did this based on the direction he got from the board.
Okay. So the only thing the little area, is it Perrinville or, I can't, who's down there? Is that Wigway? Who's, yeah. Yeah. Why divide that area?
Based on the conversation that he had with the board, and when he was councilman, when he changed a couple of things that, and really what it was is the cap District 2 on the west side of 99 was the big one. Mm-hmm. They had a spot where it came out, and it really was confusing, moved it. He had to figure out some place to... And he likes to stay less than 1% difference in population in all the districts. And at the end, if you look at where the divide is, it's 220th. It was a major road there in Eastmont, and it was very clear. South is in District 1, and north is in District 2 of 220th. He had to make a decision someplace to even up the population, and that's where he chose to do it.
Seems a little awkward. Would be my, because everything else is, like you say, pretty well divided by streets and stuff. So, I don't know.
Councilmember Frizzell?
Councilmember Hurst, if you're interested, I do have the first rendition of the map in council chambers. It's the one that I had out on the table for a few weeks. And, yeah, it got a little funky there. But some changes needed to be made to address a couple of situations.
Any other questions, council? Feedback? Any closing? Anytime. All right, thank you very much. Yeah, don't leave us. All right, we'll move right on to item D. This is an ordinance proposal for the neighborhood permit parking program. Looks like Director Franz has joined us. Sergeant Langdon. Todd Hall, do you need to be at the table? Do both of you?
Thinking.
Yeah. I think you're both pretty involved here.
All right, you ready?
Director Franz. Well, you know, turnsies.
Council, thank you for having us back tonight. Public Works Director Franz, and joining us are representatives from our traffic engineers here, and Todd from planning, and Cole, Sergeant Langdon from police. It's part of the team that has worked and put together this ordinance for your consideration tonight. If you remember, as the city is growing and new styles of development and other things appear, we're starting to feel some impacts in our neighborhoods from parking spilling over from traffic generators. First one occurred down on 209th Street, the Scriber Creek Apartments, which was in the county, and that facility was built with not enough parking for everybody who lives there who has a car or they charge for parking, and some of the folks there didn't want to pay that, and so they started crossing 204th and parking in neighborhoods in Lynnwood in and around 209th Street Southwest. More recently, the Shag Senior Housing Development on 40th, we're starting to hear some complaints from adjacent streets there about some spillover parking. And we also anticipate, as we continue to grow, perhaps seeing other types of generators that may not include multifamily. Could be things like the parking for the train when the train gets here. It could be a school. It could be a church. You know, there could be other things that generate parking and that impact neighborhoods. And so we had a good first discussion with you on July 16th. We heard concerns. I think some neighbors actually came and joined us and weighed in a little bit. And we discussed that night a potential of a permit parking program and an ordinance. And you asked for us to go take a look at that and develop something. And so we have. We've developed a draft for you. It's in your packet tonight. We looked at several examples. We'll give credit to traffic engineer Kofelt, who kind of took the authoring of it, and then the rest of the group gave him all kinds of good edits. And our city attorney has taken a look, kind of a cursory review. She didn't have time to go through it in detail before tonight, but she told me that she doesn't anticipate any substantial edits, probably just some stylistic things and so forth. And she's actually was looking at it later today. So we did try to keep the ordinance as simple as possible. We provide basic outline, and then administrative procedures would follow. But basically how it would work, if impact should happen to a neighborhood, the neighbors could contact the city, request that we take a look. The city would then verify the impact and the conditions and verify that it qualifies, and then do some education, distribute some materials that the neighbors could then talk through their neighborhood and circulate, and then ultimately a vote would occur. And the way we drafted it was that greater than 50% of the neighbors on the qualifying block would have to want to do this. And if that were the case, then we would move into implementation. Now there's some details and logistics that we would have to work out. For instance, what is this? Is it a sticker? Is it a placard that you hang from the, you know, from the rearview mirror? We haven't settled in on exactly that. I'm sure we'd look at some neighbors and examples of what they do and decide what we think might work best. But ultimately, anybody on that block that wished to get a permit for their car would come in and basically share with us their registration and their probably their license and or a utility bill or something to show that they live there and that their car lives there too. And then they would be given a permit for each of their cars, and then we put in the ordinance that availability of a guest pass also that could be given out, and then once we have that in place, then we have the ability to enforce those that don't have permits and are parking. We, of course, go out and put up no parking signs, permit parking only signs, and so forth. So that, in a very short description, is how it would work. We'd love to hear your questions and comments. I think before I ask for that, I want to see if anybody here at the table wants to say anything I missed, because I'm sure I missed something.
Actually, I think you covered it really well. There was also the opportunity for, like, not just a guest, but a temporary parking permit. So, like, as they move into the neighborhood, you'd have it come to City Hall, get a temporary parking permit to be able to load, unload.
I'll just make a comment on one of the developments that we're having challenges with is Shag. And as you know, that one was based on the parking ratios that were developed in the city center. So it's a little bit different than the one that we're faced with in the county project, whereas city center has lower ratios because in that city center, and now that we're seeing those developments be built, and especially Shag, where the anticipation was to have seniors use less cars, we're not seeing that quite yet, and knowing that Lynnwood is still car dependent. Over
point of,
time,
point of clarification, real quick, and that's the Shagum 40th, the new one.
440th, okay. Not reserve, the one that's being rebuilt. This is the one on 40th, north of 196th. Thank you. So the thought process at the time that the city center plan was developed, or the code, was to have a lower ratio for parking, and so that one led to less parking spaces, and thus we're having seen the parking challenges that were out there now. So just wanted to clarify the differences between the two projects that were contemplated on this one.
Councilmember Ross?
And this may have been covered, or I might have asked this previously, Bill, but is this going to be a permanent situation with these neighborhoods, or are we going to review it in a year, and if they're still having problems? I mean, not all neighborhoods are definitely going to have a permanent problem, is my thought.
No, and this would just be driven by those neighborhoods that are feeling an impact and come in and start the process with us. Now, okay. I'd imagine this, you know, this Erst neighborhood down on 44th would probably one that would probably need it in perpetuity, just based on what's going on across the street.
Okay. And Todd, this one may be one for you. Have we considered not allowing people to charge extra for parking spaces at apartments?
Well, that one is an interesting one. So Director Krause and I have started to mention that to a lot of developers up front, that they need to roll those costs into their rent. However, we don't have any enforceable mechanism that I am aware of that requires them to do so. So with some of the newer ones, we're mentioning that in the conditions. However, as time goes on, you know, what's the city going to do to enforce it is another situation. You know, is that going to be us? Is that going to be police? Is that going to be public works? So it's a challenge that we're going to face, obviously. And not to mention that, but also I'm just thinking on my drive to work, like down 204th, I think, there's a lot of those areas that are in our MUGA that we're going to annex. And I know that there's probably several of those developments that have the same situation where they're charging, because I see a lot of folks parking on the street. So I think it's just commonplace now that a lot of developers or the apartments, just to try to get extra money out of the residents, they're charging for that parking, and that's spilling folks out on the public streets. I see it everywhere. So it's going to be a balancing act, and I think this kind of scenario, what we're talking about, may be more prevalent as we go on. So.
Councilmember Frizzell?
We've heard a few times about the high cost of having a parking space available, but I'm curious, with the Shag property on 40th, how many parking spaces are available per unit, and is that ratio any different from the reserve, and how we can encourage that to perhaps be a higher ratio that then takes care of this problem?
Yeah, so we're well aware of the Shag case, and I think planning is going to be looking at that in the next year in terms of the parking codes, because it clearly isn't working. You know, I think it was a good idea at the time that it was proposed, but you know, it's going to take some time for City Center to change into a walkable, you know, driverless kind of community. And the intent was, okay, let's adopt this code and see kind of what happens, but we've heard loud and clear that that's not working right now. So, you know, as far as the ratios exactly, I think it makes it even more challenging, because with Shag is because you have, I don't know if it's 0.75 or 0.5, I don't know off the top of my head, I'd have to look, but I know for certain that the senior ratio for a Shag type development is even less so. So we're right. You're thinking that the idea was that seniors are going to be taking transit, or some other shuttle service or something, and they're not going to be driving as they age. Well, there's a lot of folks, obviously, that are living in shack that are still in their younger retirement years that are driving. It's only when they become, you know, at the upper end of elderly, like 75, 80 plus, that they're starting to shift away from using single occupant vehicles and then not, but that's, you know, we're seeing that most of the residents there still have their cars. So we're going to take a closer look at those city center, and Director Kleitch, you know, who's kind of the main person with the city center manager person under his purview, we're going to look at that closer and adjust those ratios, because it's obviously created a challenge that I don't think anybody really foreseen. And so we'll look at that. But in terms of like the reserve, that may be a little different. That's an HMU district. I don't know if that's a little bit. I don't know that one as well. But city center, I do know for certain that it's a lot lower of a ratio than a standard, like, one stall or one, you know, whatever it is for a multifamily.
Well, I appreciate this ordinance where we're going towards some type of a permit. I think that will give some relief to our single-family neighborhoods who are really feeling the squish. So,
yeah, for sure.
I really appreciate the work that went into this, and I think we can start talking to some of the neighbors that have real valid concerns, and hopefully let them know we're moving in that direction. So thank you.
Vice President Sessions?
Thank you. I really appreciate the variety of brains and personalities on this topic. It's a pretty fortunate topic to have all you guys on this. Good ideas. I read in there there's some room, although I don't think it's clear at the top, of possibly charging for these residential permits. I'm not sure that that's a good idea or not, but I'm just...
When we looked at some examples, there are examples of cities that these programs have grown quite large, and they have a meter paid, and you know, that somebody that patrols these. And so I think it's potential in the future. It might get to the point where costs of administering the program are high enough. We might want to consider that. But at this point, we kind of assumed we put that section in there, but we kind of assumed that there wouldn't be interest in doing that as we start and just kind of pilot this program.
Okay. And also, just for the benefit of the listeners, just to be clear that the main building we're referring to, the Scriber Creek, is out of the city limits, and not in the city limits, but they are parking in the city limits, disturbing a city of limits neighborhood. Was there anything that came up as far as being able to charge that complex with some sort of penalties or anything?
We didn't talk about that as a group. I don't know if the subgroup did.
I know that Director Krause, and he's moving behind us, he interfaced with the county about that, and I think he'll probably have something else to say. There was a lot of interaction that I and the assistant traffic engineer had with the apartment complex. How many spaces do you have? How many units do you have? And we found out some interesting things. They didn't know how many spaces, or they said they didn't know how many spaces they had. But they did know how many units they had, and they knew how many they had left to fill. And then we started learning that they weren't telling people accurately how long they might have to wait because there were no parking spaces on site left for them. And that was an important thing to recognize, is that here's a very important piece of information for somebody that's signing a lease, that there isn't a space for them if they own a car. So that might be something that would potentially become part of maybe not the parking permit, but also the decisions that the city makes as developments come in.
If I can add, Paul's right. I did contact the county. I spoke to Barb Mock and her staff several times on this project, and was hoping that they had built in some conditions of approval such that if there was a parking problem that developed, they could obligate the developer to add some. No such luck. And in fact, they came back to me and said there's nothing to enforce because it met their standards at the time. So there was nothing to be had from the county I sent certified letters to the building management and owners, basically saying if you can't cooperate with us on this, we're going to do an approach like that. I never heard back from them.
Just one last thing, and it's been mentioned here, but I mean, I know as we're growing, we're learning all the time, you know, of how to do things differently, even with our shag apartment and the front of it, and drop. Don't get me started on that, right?
Did you see their installing?
I saw it, and it was on our agenda, and we took it right off there when we saw it. So thank you. But I think it's been really clear from a lot of people, even at the council level, that everybody is not ready to go without their cars yet around here, and so hopefully we can learn from that because we're not ready.
A little bit of background, too, on the reserve. As Todd mentioned, the reserve is not in City Center. So, yes, it got the senior rate, if you will, for parking, but it was at a higher basis. And, in fact, if memory serves, they had to enlarge the lower level of that building to meet the city parking requirements.
All right, Councilor Hurst. Then Cotton, then Goodwin, then Frizzell.
So just a quick question. So on the reserve, what is the parking ratio? Do you remember?
Well, Todd's got very fast fingers on his phone. I don't remember, but I think it's something like 80% of the standard apartment rate for seniors. And that's, again, at a higher level than the City Center project started at.
And then the 15-story... by Toys R Us, isn't that a 0.75, if I remember?
I think it was higher than that. I think we got it up to Unity. Yeah, it was at one.
Okay. All right. Those were all side questions, sorry. So I'd like to go through the ordinance and just make some comments, starting with the whereas. I think we need to also realize that where we have a whereas off-site parking of tenant-owned vehicles on public street displaces and often competes with parking of vehicles associated with adjacent land uses. I think we also should put in, it's just not parking. They are blocking deliveries. They're blocking garbage trucks, accessibilities. So I think we need to realize that we're just not trying to protect people's parking spaces on the street. We are trying to protect their ability to have services delivered to them. I did have a question on Section A. It talks about parking management. So do we have it talks about a on-site parking management program. So do we have that in place for developments?
Not that I'm aware of. That was actually one of the items that I developed a whole lot further and decided that it would be handled in a different way. It would be been like a requirement for development that if you have a very low parking to unit ratio, then you need to have a parking management program with somebody who's going to keep the waiting list and inform people and however that works.
Okay.
So that could be part of what's left over from it's still draft.
Okay. Is it possible to develop that? So maybe we could put it in there too. Quit charging people for parking?
Just like that, we put those words in there.
Okay, good. Or think about it. Now, when we're verifying these blocks that possibly could have this permitting, how are we defining a block? I mean, are we setting a minimum number of houses, or how do we define that?
That's a really good question. So, in general, a block's going to be either from, one street to another, continuous land uses, residential houses, more specifically, to begin with, or it's going to be per grid. We've got a city grid that's set up, and we can call a block. This is the 3400 block of 172nd, for example. So if we don't do this by block, then we got to come up with some other way to demark it. So far, we do have a pretty consistent land use layout for our blocks in the city. We're using a grid. We can call them out. I can talk to Sergeant Langdon and say, hey, here's this block and on this street that I'm interested in. And so that works really well for identifying the areas that are going to be subject to a proposal for permitted parking.
Okay, so that's going to define how many residents there are, or houses or whatever, because they have to get a certain percentage.
Exactly, right. And so the materials that are prepared by the traffic engineers proposed in the ordinance would include all the properties on that block, and then they would be contacted.
As I went out and looked at down at, is it 209th Street that comes in off 44th, it seemed to be most of the impact was on 209th, but then you have streets that go northward that had probably some impact. Mm-hmm. So I would, I'd imagine as we'd look at that area, we'd make some educated guesses on where the area of impact is, and then we'd probably have to make some educated guesses if we mark parts of it that they might go a little farther and start parking. So, you might start chasing your tail a little bit.
Right.
So it's going to be a little bit of art, too, I think, in figuring out the impact area.
It's true. And as we prepare the materials, we've got resources, interdepartmental resources. We'll talk together and see what makes the most sense.
Okay. All right. And I don't want to get into the weeds, but maybe where it says if a block does not qualify, the process ends, that maybe the council could be notified, because I'm sure the neighborhoods will. They'll probably self-notify.
Sure, yes. Somewhere that we've got sharing of the information in case there's somebody that comes back around from the neighborhood to say, well, the process was completed, and so you can move on, come back in a year, I guess.
Okay. And then my concern on qualifying properties, where it says cul-de-sacs and similar residential street terminations with fire access requirements may not qualify. I think that's, I'm not quite sure why that's there, because I think that's one thing we're trying to free up, is that, especially on 209th, there's a cul-de-sac that's getting filled with people that should have permit. So if we don't allow that permitting to happen in that cul-de-sac, then they're just going to fill up in there.
So that's a very fair point to make. We need to loop in the fire marshal with the cul-de-sacs, because we've got some pretty small cul-de-sacs, and if permitted parking is allowed there, then we're not going to have enough room for the fire trucks to get in and out.
Well, I think the permitting would be to prevent, I mean,
to prohibit parking.
Yeah, folks are going to want to park in there. Driveways.
Yeah.
Once they get a permit, I don't think they're going to say, I'm going to park on the street now. So I think
we can write that a little better, make it a little clearer.
And then the section about parking permit fees, I'm just going to cross that out right now. I don't think we can charge residents fees. I did have a question on the guest parking permit, where we're talking about guest vehicle license plates and name of guest may require registration into city parking records. I didn't understand that, because I think a guest one would just be something you hang on your mirror, wouldn't it?
Sure. It depends on how specific or how easy we want to make this on both the public works and enforcement. A lot of what you see in the draft ordinance comes from a 40-year permit parking in Montgomery County, Maryland, state of Maryland.
Okay.
So this was a very mature program that paralleled the ideas and thoughts that I had had. And this was actually, this permit parking ordinance dovetailed on a cul-de-sac parking program that we had in Public Works for the last 6 years. It wasn't ordinance, it was policy. And we let the impacted residents vote. But it had to be approved by the fire marshal, whether or not they could park in there. So the Montgomery County in Maryland, for the guest parking, they would do all of the guests and even the resident parkings tied in with the vehicle registrations. And so it made things a lot easier in their database.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably not what we're going to be able to do right out of the gate. But, that's why you see that in
that's
there, registering, or keeping a database.
Okay, and then as far as enforcement, it says vehicles parked in permit-restricted areas without a valid permit are subject to ticketing, towing, and impound according to local and state code. So I think one of the problems that I hear is that cars sit in these neighborhoods for not just days, but for months. We're not towing things. We're not moving them. And so I guess the question, maybe Sergeant Langen can respond to this, you know, how enforced are we going to be? Are we going to give them 24 hours, 48 hours?
It's going to be dependent on the vehicle, but basically it's going to be escalating. So if we have a vehicle that's parked in a permitted area without a permit, it would receive an infraction. Once it's there for 7 days, which is standard policy right now, we would then move towards impounding the vehicle at that point. And we go through the proper notification to registered owner or attempted notification. So that would happen just like if we have another non-safety-related violation right now in another part of the city. Right. So it'd be escalating.
Great. All right. Well, I mean, yeah, it's obvious this is a lot of work, and it's I appreciate everything that's gone into this and look forward to when do you think we'll have a polished ordinance as far as not just a draft to come forward?
I guess we'd look to you to maybe get a little direction on when you know, we can probably turn around something fairly quick. I don't know if next Monday's too early for you or if we...
No, I don't think...
I mean, if you want to see it again before, we could go another cycle of work session and regular session or not.
Well, you can think about that. We'll get through our questions first. Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor. And thank you, parking permit team, for all coming together and collaborating on this. I appreciate seeing us putting our heads together on this. Kind of just a high-level question. In reading through this, and I apologize if maybe I missed it in reading through here, this doesn't appear to be formatted as an LMC. Could you talk about that? Why or maybe it is. I don't know. Is this?
As I said before, the city attorney is looking at it for edits, and we expect she said there'll be some stylistic changes.
Okay.
She doesn't see a whole lot of content issues, but more stylistic things. So that's probably what you're getting at is just. The layout maybe looking a little more like you're used to seeing.
Yeah, I'm wondering, and then, you know, will this be a new section of the LMC, or will this be a dovetail in as a subsection to an existing section?
I would anticipate that it would be a new section of the LMC.
Okay, great. So I think our city attorney is probably going to hit on any of my other stuff, which is really kind of the formatting, having a good definition section where we kind of maybe talk about, you know, what is a block, what is a, you know, kind of how we've been cleaning up the rest of our codes. This is an excellent first pass, especially at putting together something that we've never had before. So I really appreciate the work that's gone into this. I appreciate all the work that's gone into it. And I'll be interested definitely from a process standpoint to see what the attorney comes back with and then let you – I'll kind of review that and maybe kind of go through a couple more iterations before it comes back. I think this is something that is important enough that we want to do. We definitely want to do it quickly, but once we roll something like this, you know, once you kind of release it into the world, it becomes harder to pull it back. So I'd like it to be right, as right as it can be, as quick as it can be, which is always the I want it 100% right now. But, you know, if we could just do our best on that. But I would like to maybe see it again in another draft form after the city attorney's seen it, just to review it some more from a process standpoint.
Council President.
Thank you. The questions that I had have been answered. I do want to, again, say thank you for the work that you've done on this. This is something that council leadership will discuss tomorrow about. It's next week is definitely too early. I mean, you know, we need to have another work session. We need to discuss it. My assumption also will be that there will be some sort of a notification period as well once it's enacted to those affected areas. And again, as seen in the draft, you know, there are a number of steps to take before that this goes into effect in a specific area. But I think the other reason that I think next week is too soon is because we want the city attorney to look at it also and go through it very carefully to make sure that it's quite defensible and that we get those things right that we need to make sure that the onus is on those that are committing the infractions and not those that live in the neighborhood. You know, we don't want the citizens that are having these issues to be the ones that ultimately pay. And so I think we want to make sure that we do everything we can to make sure that that's not the case, that the case is that those that are causing the disturbances are the ones that are held accountable for what they're doing. So that's all that I have. Thanks.
Councilmember Frizzell?
I noticed that a lot of the ordinance deals with parking generators. But what about those areas of the city that we don't necessarily have that situation? I'm thinking of 52nd by Kaiser Permanente. I've talked to a number of single-family residents in that neighborhood who are concerned about the broken-down RVs and the disabled cars that park along there. I know Sergeant Langdon spoke a bit to that as far as vehicles, but does this ordinance deal at all with that situation that has been an eyesore for so long?
Well, I suppose we could, you know, we could have a liberal, more liberal type of definition of what a generator, what a parking generator might be. It doesn't have to just be a multifamily apartment within X number of feet. And like I said when I started tonight here, it could be, you know, a church, a school, the transit center. It could be an area of town that for some reason attracts semis that want to park their trailer overnight or, you know, or for extended periods. So that may be one way to get at that concern.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Councilor Hurst?
Just one last comment that I would hope that we could be able to still pass something, though, this year. I know this problem, the specific neighborhood I'm thinking of started in March of 2017. And so it's been a festering problem, and this is a great start. And I think there'll be time for the city attorney to look at it. We have another work session that we could still pass this before the end of the year. That'd be my hope. Thank you.
Anything else? Thank you.
Thank you.
Team parking. Council, do you want to carry on with your next one, or do you want your scheduled break? Actually, it's not scheduled break. Time-wise, it's scheduled break. Can you do one more, at least? Are you good? Okay. Let's move on to item E. This is project updates, civic center parking and building upgrades, and the criminal justice facility improvements.
All right, we have parking team two joining us at the table tonight. Chief and parks director, and then part of my staff is here who's doing project management, Nick Barnett. It's at the color commentary table, and then our new employee, our new civil engineer, Amy Hansen. Just wanted to introduce her to you. She's been here a couple weeks now and in our project management group, too. So for her first chance to come and watch the council do their work. So tonight we wanted to give you some updates on three main topics and some of those with some subtopics. We've been making good progress on issues related to our buildings and parking areas, but as we've gotten into some of the plans that we've laid originally, we've come up against some things that have made us pause and consider maybe better ways and better things to do. So let me kind of step through these, and then I think the gentlemen to my left and right probably have some things to add too, but to start with, if you remember back in 2012, we purchased the Rostad property, which is just to the west of the fire station. It's it had a single-family greenhouse on it that we ended up tearing down. But we bought that in 2012 for that big piece of property that ultimately can hold three lots. We purchased that for a whopping $215,000 at the time, which seemed like a lot of money. I'm guessing if we turn around and sold that property now, it'd probably be $700,000-$800,000 based on what things are going for in the neighborhood here. So that was a good investment for the city in more than one way. It's adjacent to the and close to the rec center, which has a documented need probably for more parking at certain times. And so when we purchased that, we had a couple of understandings. At the time, we thought that the obvious use of that property was for parking. We also wanted to preserve the beautiful sequoia tree that was planted by the Rosteds there on that property in, I believe, the 1960s. And so we set out to look at seeing how much parking we could fit on that site and preserve the tree. And as we progressed through design, between the tree and – Nick, do you want to show the next slide? So that's – to the right is 188th Street Southwest, and at the bottom there is the fire station and existing parking just above that, to the west of that. And then the grayed area would be the layout of parking that we looked, and you see that big white spot he's pointing at is the size of the spot necessary to be able to – keep that sequoia tree healthy. That's the location of the tree. So as we looked at that, and also as we pave, we'd have to pave such a large area, some pretty stringent stormwater regulations kick in. And when we were getting cost estimates to construct that, we were up in the $1.2 million range or worse.
So project total climbed to $1.2 million for construction, with $500,000 of that being just the storm detention.
And when we did the math of, you know, cost per parking spot, the number was we thought it a bit high. And so we started questioning and wondering, might there be a better way? So then let me leave you hanging there for a moment. Let's talk about kind of the overall civic campus and some parking issues here. Back to the main picture if you want something to ask questions about. So parking needs in our campus here, depending on the day, we can be short on parking, and it can be difficult to find spots. We have lots of things going on between the library, meetings at City Hall, regular business at City Hall, the senior center at the NAB, the rec center, and the fire station. And so we can have challenges with parking. We've also, as you know, have had growing concerns with safety in our parking stalls or our parking areas. These have increased over the past several years as some of our societal issues have increased. We've really worked hard over the last couple of years to cut back vegetation, to enhance the lighting that we have. We've added cameras. We've educated our staff on how to stay safe. We've recently added some temporary lighting, and as we continue to figure out the best ways to deal with safety, that this also will affect what we might do in the future with parking. We've also are under further requirements from the federal government on our Americans with Disability Act or ADA requirements that have to do with parking layouts and wheelchair ramps and things like that. These standards that as we better understand them, will also affect our parking. The council also has expressed an interest in adding another reader board, similar to what's up at the rec center, but down somewhere more near the vicinity of City Hall, and how that may be located comes into the mix. So we have a definite need for parking up north where we were. Due to the rec center, we were going to locate it on a site up there. We thought, well, you know, there might be better ways to spread this out through the whole civic center and avoid some of those exorbitant costs. And then as we start thinking of these things, all these things I just mentioned a moment ago with safety and ADA, the reader board, all kind of complicate ultimately the design. And so, again, we wanted to pause and be thoughtful about our approach to this. So one measure we've recently undertaken is we've begun a space study analysis This has been in the capital budget in this current biennium. We've started the work earlier this summer. We have a consultant on board. They've just begun doing data collection of the uses of our main municipal buildings on this campus, head counts, how much space per person, how many parking spots per person and per function for what we have here to get a handle on what our needs are today. And they're also going to look out into the future, too, and do some projections. That'll be very important data that will help help us deal with these parking questions that we're dealing with here. And as we start especially as we start talking about the future, then we get into these bigger questions that we've been chewing on a little bit over the last 10, 15 years with the city center and the thought of where is our future of some of these functions and buildings. Is it here on this campus? Is it, you know, downtown? So those are things that we want to be thoughtful about before we sink a whole lot of money into a facility that we might decide in a few years we're going to change the function of again. So I thought it important to come and talk to you and explain to you why we're pausing a bit on some of these plans that we had started on. We some of these temporary lighting things we did in the parking lot, we had talked to the council about getting out there quickly and doing some more permanent things. That didn't seem like it made good sense now that the whole configuration of the parking could change as we try to fit more parking in and do all these other things we're talking about. We wanted to make sure that it was safe in the interim as we spend some time wrestling with its decisions. The second part of what the briefing was tonight has to do with what a similar kind of thing that police is just starting to undertake with the part of the civic center across 44th where the police station sits. The chief is prepared to speak to that briefly. I wanted to ask if it might be better to take questions on the first part before we do that, or I wanted you to know he's also here to do that too.
Take questions on the first part, comments, issues, concerns. Councilmember Ross.
Thank you for saving the tree.
Councilmember Hurst.
So since it's not going to turn into a parking lot with the property we bought, what are the thoughts? Are we thinking of a mini park, or what are we doing?
Thank you for asking that. I think Bill did a very good job of providing you the background. And by the way, that entire rendering and discussion about parking was also thoroughly vetted with the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board last year. They spent a number of meetings going over this with Project Manager Barnett and Public Works team, Jared Bond, also looking at creative ways to deal with the stormwater. And it was ultimately discussed in the solution to keep it, because you will destroy that tree by paving it eventually. Might not happen right away, but over time it will. So we have preliminarily looked at this property because it has a lot of utility, and it's connected to the Masika Trail, and it could be turned into a very nice trailhead, opened up nice view from 188th, could serve some of the programmatic issues that we have at the rec center, because the rec center doesn't have a lot of program space. During the nice times of the year, if there was a shelter out there, we could have some activities out there. But I think the property sets up very well for a park, a small park connected to the Masika Trail and also the connectivity to the neighborhood across the street and to the school. So I think there's a lot of potential there.
Right. And then as far as because now we won't have that as a parking space. I know when we were talking about the Regional Fire Authority planning, the issue of the fire department parking spaces by Station 15 was left to further discussion. And I don't know if the RFA board has discussed at all the fact that I think the fire department has 15 parking spaces around the station, and perhaps they could reduce that number, utilize the parking spaces across the street for some of the fire guys, and then, you know, the chief cars and everything, they can always park in front instead of having permanent spaces. So because now that we've lost that possibility of adding that parking space, I would hope perhaps our representatives on the board could talk about that with your fellow commissioners.
We would totally agree with that. Actually, we've had that same conversation internally, that as the RFA now is settled in and we can start to revisit some of those housekeeping items, because that's on our list too. Those are really desirable spaces for the rec center and for the entire campus.
And I think they said they'd be willing to go down to 14, so can discuss that. But no, it's not something that has come up since Councilmember Frizzell and I have been there. So.
Vice President Sessions?
Thank you. Just on the same topic of the fire department parking, there was also the consideration of, because I think that they probably need more parking spaces than you think, but what about that north side? We're thinking about or opening up the north side of the building to have slanted in spots. That has that been considered? I mean, that wouldn't be our deal. It could be theirs, but
we took that concept to 30% design. It had a price tag of about $300K to net 8 spaces to do that. And most of the concern was, in order to put that parking along the north side and not have it utilized by anybody else, it would have to be pass restricted with a gate so that they would be able to get through. So that's what kind of, at that point, driving that project up to 1.5 to include that, which is why it was then cut from the original analysis.
Is that our property?
I believe so, as much as...
Well, I believe that's RFA.
Okay.
We're talking north of the building, between the building and 188th, which, and I believe that whole lot, mm-hmm. it now is RFA.
It has an additional concern also, in that it's currently a bioswell, so if that gets paved over, that's another drainage issue in a hard pan area.
Okay, thank you. But about the parking lot, or the city hall parking lot, and we've talked about this, and I sure appreciate the temporary upgrades that have been made. It's better than it was, for sure. You also did the repainting as well, which helped, I think. But those extra lights especially, although they're not, they're just temporary. Hurst, they're just temporary. Because they're not dark sky, but it's only temporary. So all this makes sense. It's logical. And especially moving forward, you know, we don't want to put too much money into something that we might be changing. We get that. But so how soon, I mean, how long are we just going to, we may or may not do this? I mean, how long is that going to go around?
Well, it's a step at a time. And, you know, we're underway with the space study. And remind me, Nick, the timeline to get that data.
The expectation is to have a report in front of council for review in February, late February, early March of 2019.
2019.
Correct.
Okay. All right. That sounds good to me. Thank you.
Any other questions, comments on this? All right. Let's move on to Chief Davis.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. Wanted to present to you tonight, just to let you know where we're at on our project. If you'll recall, about 25 years ago, the city moved the police department into a existing office space that was converted to a police station and jail. And so what we've done, because of our space needs, and you all have been there as well, is we used a 2025 square footage estimate that we had an architect dust off an older study and validate the space needs for us. And we looked at having the ability to use a co-locating on a site that's next to us there, and you'll see that in the diagram. That's the wooded area that the city currently owns. Our goal was to use existing jail, if possible, to reduce construction costs, keep court and jail co-located, to reduce transportation and staff costs, and improve parking and parking circulation. So we embarked on that, and the existing site combined with the adjacent city-owned lot has been analyzed by KMD and determined that land area could, in fact, accommodate the square footage that we would need for an expanded jail, court, and police department. The result of that examination that we had conducted was favorable. Next slide, if you would. Thank you. So one of the things as we embarked on this is we began to interact with some of our community partners. And we had an initial meeting with a large group. The mayor was at that initial meeting, and Bill Franz was at that initial meeting, and we had Community Health Center. And if you recall, could you actually go back to the previous slide? Thank you. To the far right of the wooded area, the next lot to the right over there, yes, would be Community Health Center, and you're all familiar with that. CHC serves a population very similar to the population that ends up oftentimes being incarcerated that we're responsible for. And in this conversation with them, they are interested in partnering with us to provide perhaps some different kinds of treatment options within our facility. The location that they're at and the parking needs that they have has been somewhat fortuitous for us. And so we've, in fact, had another meeting today with them. It's the third one I think we've had. And they're very interested in partnering. So our current jail, you all have been in it, and so I won't talk too much about it. But what we're looking at doing is creating a new civic center, justice center project that would have, if you go back to the other slide, thank you. It would have an opportunity to have a location that opens up to the public, a place that allows us to do treatment, a place that allows us to have CHC be inside our facility and do medically assisted treatment for addiction, chemical dependency, mental health services. And the other thing that's important to note is that what we'd be talking to them about is doing what we really would call a kind of a soft handoff. And so if somebody's in our facility and receiving treatment, they also accept AppleCare and some of the other DSHS services, that in fact a person could begin treatment or begin doing court-ordered requirement. And that could be things like anger management. It could be things like a mandated testing that the state requires for certain kinds of convictions, and all of that prior to ever leaving custody. And the reason that's important is, and I know Paulette's here and is in support of this project, is that if a judge oftentimes will, as part of sentencing, require someone go get alcohol or drug assessment out of custody, sometimes they do it once they're out of custody, and sometimes they don't. And if they don't, they end up failing to comply with the judge's order, and a warrant will be issued, and the whole cycle starts all over again, and they end up on the co-op, and we pay to have them housed somewhere, and we get all into these jail cost issues. The judge is amenable to just directing them right to having that done right inside the facility before they ever leave, and they could comply with all those orders. So there's so many other things that I don't want to take too much time to talk about tonight, but there's great opportunity for us to partner. There's great opportunities to provide proper, adequate, more than adequate, acceptable, expected service to members of our community, and have this partnership with CHC that allows them to continue treatment with their same care provider once they leave custody. And in fact, because of their location, we darn near could have a walkway between us, quite frankly. And so that partnership is continuing to grow, and those benefits, I think, are still yet to be fully kind of vetted. There are also some opportunities to reduce operational costs, which could be applied to the project expense as well. Things such as we would bring our evidence facility back. We're currently paying a lease to the college for that, and that's always, while they're a great landlord and a great partner, we always hear conversations about what are they going to do if they want to expand or grow. We have an opportunity through expanding the jail to save contract housing costs. We estimate that to be about $1 million a year that we think we could save. Our evidence lease rental is $200,000 a year. Our medical service partnership with CHC could be somewhere around $350,000 a year. And there's other numbers here, contract revenues and other opportunities that will come back and present more information to you later. Currently, we've earmarked about $1.3 million out of our 105 fund in the current capital budget to move forward with the actual design. The leadership at the PD is currently working with the Strategic Planning Steering Committee and intend to present a more detailed examination of the project in the near term to them as well. We believe that we can cover most of the costs for repayment, not all of it, but most of the debt repayment, just again through bringing an enhancement of our operations back into the police department. That coupled with what I would consider a very qualitative improvement to the quality of life and the opportunity for treatment for many individuals, as well as a community storefront in which some other service providers are interested in being present right there on our site, which would not be in the secure area but in a semi-secure area, is a great opportunity as well. So we'd like to continue moving forward with this project. We'll come back to you with much more detail when we have that. But the next thing is to move forward with the actual design and actually have people start to look at, developers start to look at some actual costs and start to narrow those down. But again, we're very, very optimistic about the timing, the location of the property that the city currently owns, and the location with our community partner over at CHC, and some enhancements that I think that we can do that are in line with the city's vision and align with our priorities and for city government as well. So that's it, and I'm happy to answer any questions if you have any tonight.
I can't tell you how excited I am about this. The partnership, the coordination of benefits, the idea of bringing someone into custody and then releasing them back on the street without having been able to impact them as much as we would like. I like the idea of partnering with the court system. There's nothing I don't like about this idea. And I am curious about one item under on your chart with the cost mitigation. One of the items that you have there about impact on the city budget is jail revenue. Are you anticipating that we would have the capacity to take in more prisoners from other facilities and recoup in that way?
We are. The design would allow us to double our bed space and increase the square footage per inmate as well. And that square footage doesn't go in the form of just the housing. It goes in the form of community areas and rec areas as well, things that we're significantly lacking right now. So the answer is yes. And also keep in mind that if we there's an economy of scale. So if we're able to go from 46 beds to, say, 100 beds, we currently are obligated, the city of Lynnwood is obligated to, 80 to 90 inmates every single day. We don't have that capacity, so we're paying millions of dollars a year for contract housing. So if we are able to double our bed space within this project, bring our inmates that we're responsible for back into this programming, this wonderful space, then we also may have the capacity, we believe, to also provide contract housing for other cities that may be interested in doing that. And I think that there will be a real interest in doing that. We did a very conservative, if we just did 10 beds, contracted 10 beds at $120 a day, and anybody knows the costs that you've seen in our bills, that's a grossly conservative number. That's $450,000 a year right there. And so we do think we have the capacity to do that potentially as part of the scope of the examination of the project.
And with the increased bed space, we're then required to provide other services. Is that correct? Recreational, et cetera.
We actually currently provide contract housing right now. We just turn it off because we're full oftentimes with our own inmates. So we do have the contracts in place now to do that, and we would just expand that.
All right.
But the level of service that we could provide to people that are incarcerated would be incredibly higher. Mm-hmm. It'd be where they should be.
Yeah.
Councilor Sutton?
Thank you, Mayor. I was just discussing with a couple of residents about this expansion of the Justice Center. And they recall somewhere along the line that there had already been some studies done. And I don't know if they're on the shelf somewhere or have any of those surfaced that we could possibly just kind of get an idea of what was planned then and see how that will influence what we plan in the future.
Excellent question. There was a space study need done in 1999. There was another one done in 2004. And there was another one done in 2009. What we did with concurrence with the city was we reached out to KMD Architects. They did the 2009 study. And we asked them to re-examine that study based on current staffing models and a projected 2025 need, space need. And so we, in fact, did that. And we were able to they were willing to do that, and they did it for we paid for that cost out of the city budget, and they did that for significantly less. So we did not – that's an excellent question. We did not actually ask for another fourth study to be done. We asked them to actually validate the 2009 study. So, yeah.
Very good. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Councilor Hurst.
No, I think this is a great idea. Really exciting possibilities. And when you said it was 25 years ago, shoot, I supplied the lighting for this job. And I didn't think it was that long ago. So, oh well, time marches on, you know.
Any other questions, Councilmember Cotton?
Thank you, Honor. No questions, really. Just I'm very excited to hear things like partnerships and you know, and being a regional model as part of this discussion. So thank you for carrying that torch.
All right. Thank you very much. All right. Do you want to break now or do you want to keep going? Five-minute break.
Mayor?
Yes.
What I would like to do before we get started on that is have a proposal to move the Youth Commission Task Group discussion to December 3rd. And what I would like to do is at our meeting tomorrow, leadership, see what that meeting looks like, the agenda, if it looks like it's going to be too much to be able to have a discussion like this evening. Next Monday, I'll bring that back and say, but otherwise have planned to have this discussion on December 3rd. If there's
sounds good to me.
Questions or comments or a motion or...
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Okay. Any more discussion? All those in favor, please say aye. Moving the discussion to December 3rd. So documented by Art Suniza.
Done.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now we'll move on to G, now that we've done H, because everything's in order. This is our 2019-2020 budget presentation from Community Development. And I was just sharing with them, they're the last presentation, but they're not the least. So thank you for your attention, and you are getting recorded, just like every other department.
Okay, well,
all right.
Thank you for accommodating me in particular. You may have heard that I was out of town last week taking care of my mother, and I have to go back down there. But I appreciate your having us on tonight. Community Development Department is obviously a key factor in the development of our community and creating the vision, realizing the vision, cleaning up nuisances, permitting, business licensing, human services. We do a lot of things in a lot of areas. Earlier this summer, and this didn't make it onto the slide, but earlier this summer, Andrew Ballard came in and was working with the entire DBS staff to develop an overall mission statement. And it was rather expansive, and maybe, well, basically, it's we strive to ensure our city is the safest, most livable, and sustainable community in the region. Now, that was the efforts of about, we had about 30 people in the room that day. You know? We could only do it in the afternoon, and we didn't have time to do the second half, which would have been developing unique vision statements, mission statements for each of the four departments that make up DBS. Community development is in the process of doing that. We stuck our draft mission statement in there. We had a team of employees working on that. We had different versions. We had ones that were very long and precise, and there was an urge to have one that was something that people could actually remember and understand and was succinct. It was creating a lasting legacy for our community through compassion, professionalism, dedicated public service, innovative practices and technology, and providing equitable opportunities for a diverse community. We'll be working to perfect that a little bit more in the coming weeks. And again, I think David told me that he touched on this. A lot of times people interchangeably use community development and business services center. And community development is a component of the development and business services center. The DBS center is actually comprised of four staff from four different departments. It's all of community development, all of economic development, it's public works, development services staff, and it's the fire marshal's office. And that's the way the center was set, the original permit center was set up. We have staff in the building that are responsible to four different department heads. And we generally are able to work together cooperatively, and we've been working a lot on procedures and policies and getting things moving. So, yeah, it was created in 2007. We used to be over on the campus here. It was set up as a one-stop shop, and we've expanded that once those one-stop shop services. I mean, this goes back to the days when you would come over to the NAB to make an application for a building permit, and then we'd say, okay, go back over to City Hall and pay for it, and they'd come back over and show us a receipt, and then we say, well, now you got to talk to Public Works, and they're back in that other building there. And if it was raining, people were getting really angry, understandably. And so we've been building on that for a long time. So we've assembled everybody in the building who works on development services and other things. And it's really been a successful concept, but we're trying to kick it into the next level as we speak. What you have up there is one of our newest and most exciting things. That's the page that you get when you want to do online permitting. We have gone live. This is our portal. We have gone live with what we're calling over-the-counter permits. Those are the ones that don't require detailed plan review. They require an application. They require paying for it, and then they require calling for an inspection. We go out, and when you do the inspection, you can sign it off and approve it. This portal is also where you go when you want to request inspections, and I'll touch on that in a minute. But it's as we're expanding the capabilities of our InterGov permitting system, we keep adding things that we can do online here. The goal is to have every application online by early next year. We had to wait until there was a major update to the InterGov system. IT got that in and working a couple weeks ago, so we're about ready to take some of the next steps. Again, community development, one of four departments in the DBS Center. We're divided into three divisions. Administration, which we've kind of collapsed the administrative function. We have moved staff around a lot over the years to meet needs. We used to have a separate administrator who worked with me on budget and other things. We did away with that position. One of the positions, one of the many positions we moved and did away with. But administration also includes our permit counter operation. It includes Kathy and her staff, and includes me. And then we have our planning and human services, which is the smallest group. We're down to three people at the moment. And all our long range planning comes through there. All our ordinance development comes through there. We've piggybacked on the human services function into there, and we're working with the mayor on refining the human services delivery right now. And then we have permits and inspections under Stacy Criswell. That's probably our largest group. That's the one that's primarily responsible, although we all touch base on it, for the amount of development that's under construction in the city. of course, we have the standard look back of how do our programs fit with the community vision and with this outcome strategic plan priorities. You know, because we have so much cross-pollinization, it was harder to figure out which boxes we didn't check than the ones that we did, because we fit into most of the categories. The community development proposed budget for the next biennium is just under $7 million. I point out that so far this year we've taken in, $210,000 in permit fees, I think the last time I looked. We're taking in approximately, $2 million. I was off by a zero. Yeah, well, that's on construction value. But it's the permit fees are over $2 million. So if you look at that and you project it forward, at least $4 million, given the development rate that we're going with, $4 million of the cost of operating community development is offset by developer fees. There's a reason why it's not 100%. It's because not everything we do is attributed to developers. We can only charge a developer for providing a service. When we write a new code, or we develop a neighborhood plan, or we go out on code enforcement, or maintain the comprehensive plan, all of that is general fund supported and has to be, because it's not development related. But we do offset a considerable sum of the cost. Accomplishments for the current biennium. Well, on the early part of that, we established the Human Services Commission, they have done a lot of work in the areas of housing, homelessness, youth services, and whatnot. In the first round of the grant program, and I think it was only with $75,000, actually 2,000 Lynnwood residents were given services, ranging from job training to counseling, to drug addiction services, employment counseling. There was a signing up for benefits that they were eligible for. So 2,000 Lynnwood residents were served. And in a separate part of it, there were 35,000 meals given out, partially through Neighbors in Need, although most of it was through homage. In terms of the numbers. Lynnwood Link LRT is in final design with construction underway. So that's a big hurdle for the current biennium. We're also working on ST3. Actually, we've started planning the next phase. And if, you know, ST2 was approved by the voters in 2008. And we were working on it for 2 or 3 years before it was approved by the voters. And now you're just starting to see demolition. So that gives you a feel for the time frame that it takes to bring these things forward. So we're working on ST3, extension of light rail to Everett. We're also working on the first ST3 project that's going to be up and running, and that's Councilman Hurst is on the committee for that, the I-405 bus rapid transit routing that will start in the Lynnwood Transit Center, go all the way around through Bellevue and down to Burien. That will be up and running in the same 2024 timeframe that the light rail is from ST2. Online permitting is a big thing for us. We got, as I say, all the over-the-counter permits online right now. And that significantly is not just building and electrical, but it includes fire permitting as well. I thought Kevin Zwieber might make it tonight. I heard he was at a neighborhood meeting. We'll get to his budget in a little bit because the fire marshal's budget is subsumed within community development. We are managing the contract for that now. But Kevin did remarkably good work, and you saw the efforts with that, where the Title IX that was what made Lynnwood unique and expensive and sometimes infuriating in terms of standards that were unique to Lynnwood that were now excessive. Kevin rewrote the whole thing so that we are now fairly standardized with, you know, you're going to be asked to do the same thing here as you would in Edmonds and Mount Lake Terrace. He also completely overhauled, and this was with the fee work that we did earlier this year, he rewrote the fee structure for fire, making it much simpler and allowing a lot of his permits to be over the counter. So if you have five devices or less, if you're putting in five sprinkler, moving five sprinkler heads, or putting in a sending unit or something else, that's over the counter. You just make the application, you pay for it, and call for an inspection. So he's done great work with that. So all our over-the-counter permits are now online. You can pay for them online. There's still the occasional glitch that IT is working out. For example, we found out that our program is not too discriminating if you are in the county and you apply for a permit in Lynnwood. It'll sometimes give it to you. We found out that there's a switch that IT can throw to stop that, so we're working with them on that. Earlier this summer, all inspection requests were moved online. We used to have to come in early in the morning and be on the phone for an hour and a half to 2 to 3 hours, actually orally, taking inspection requests, writing down what we think they said, because sometimes people are hard to understand, and which permit we thought they were talking about, and then put up a work list for what needed to be done, what inspections needed to be done that day. It's now all online. We turned off the phone, not only is the inspection online, but our inspection reports are online. So all our inspectors, and including all the fire inspectors, and I believe Public Works now too, are all equipped with iPads. They write their inspections in the field, and they send the report out so the contractor gets the report. And one of the things I insisted on is I wanted the owner, building owner, to get the report as well, because it's a historic problem. You know, we believe we've informed the contractor of a need to do something, perhaps several times. The contractor might not have ever told the owner. And then when things go awry, they say, well, the city is making me do something. They're changing their minds. They're being arbitrary. And this way, the owner doesn't have to read it, but we're giving the owner the opportunity to stay in the loop. Other things that are significant with inspections is we used to have paper inspection reports. I think we staple one copy to the wall, and the other one was one of those, what do you call it? It made the copy. That's what we used to call them. But, yeah, it was modern kind of copy. And those would all get thrown into an inbox where Kathy's people would then have to file them. Paper inspection reports filed with paper files from building permits. And it was just a recipe for a huge amount of time waste, and things would get lost. We couldn't do it. It didn't catch up. Now it's just they put the inspection report. It goes out online. It's automatically in the file, which is now digital. If you look in our file storeroom, this was one of the things the mayor challenged us with. We had boxes of paper files that were not only on shelves, but they were piled up in our hallway in the old building and sometimes blocking the bathroom. And when the roof would leak, which it often did, they would get wet. Those have now all been digitized. It was 100, yeah. I think it was like 130 or something like that, crates. Yeah, and then the plans, they are now all digital, and we're getting stuff in digitally, more and more stuff, so it'll never be in paper. We've managed a fourfold increase in development activity with actually fewer staff than we had in 2006 when I came here. So we've had a fourfold increase in what's happening in the city. And in terms of permit volumes and permit value, it's more than that. It's Lynnwood is experiencing the highest construction rate in its history. We're finding ways to do it without staffing, although it's pushing the envelope. The biggest thing that we've done is we're outsourcing virtually all of our plan reviews. We can tap into expertise in consulting firms. We've got three firms that we ship most of it out to. And all of the Sound Transit work is going to be shipped out on a contract as well. And, in fact, we're going to have the contractor do the inspection, a lot of the inspection work, if not all of it, for the Sound Transit. We completed a comprehensive analysis of development permit fees, and that's across the entire DBS operation, except business licensing, which we're still working on. And those fees were adopted by you earlier this summer with a two-month delay in getting them put into operation so that IT could have time to enter the data. That was done in early October, and they're all live. Business licensing was brought into the center in 2017. We converted business licensing from an extinct program that was no longer supported into the InterGov system that's our backbone system. We have a major overhaul of the entire business licensing ordinance that is ready to go, and we're scheduled to come to the next finance committee meeting to start that discussion. Conversion of planning files to digital, we talked about. Oh, we actually cut the time for plan review in half. And there really wasn't that much magic to it. We were to the point where we couldn't open up a set of plans because we just didn't have anybody. I mean, everybody was fully committed and working overtime and sometimes weekends. It took 12 weeks to get a set of plans open. Now, within a much shorter period of time, we do a completeness check and we ship it out to one of our firms. And so the reviews are coming back quicker. And, of course, we continue to reorganize the department, and that's an ongoing effort. There's some analysis of departmental operations going on now. I know the mayor has reserved some resources so that hopefully once we get some decisions made, we can actually implement some of them. For the next biennium, we want to complete the conversion of over to digital online permitting. We need to manage the permitting construction inspections for Lynnwood Link. This is going to be, I mean, if we're doing $200 million worth of development in a year, over $200 million, the Sound Transit alone is over that. And will be for several years running. So the only way we could do that is to kind of segment it out and handle it with a construction contract that David and his staff has been working on with Sound Transit. Again, we started to work on ST3 and the BRT. We want to complete the analysis of DBS procedures, staffing, and incorporate recommendations, budget support. One of the things that I really want to bring back to you is I've asked the council several times over the last decade to think about a rental housing business license and inspection program. And I've had some encouragement from several of you and the Human Services Commission to try one more time with that. Some of the housing in Lynnwood is affordable because it's not very good or it's not maintained well. And we can't get into the housing unless we're invited in. And when things get really bad, sometimes we're invited in and we find mold or we find ceilings that leak like a sieve or electrical problems. What a housing inspection program would do is it would say that renting housing in Lynnwood is a business. As a business, it requires, whether it's a single-family house that you're renting out or a 300-unit apartment building, it requires a business license to operate, and to get the business license, you're going to have a periodic inspection by a certified inspector that you meet minimal standards. There's some state laws that come into play. I think you can't do it more than once every 4 years, and you got to give the property owner the ability to either hire their own inspector, but you can set the standards of what you want, or they could take out a permit from the city and we can do it. So that's something I really want to bring back to you. Every 5 years or so, is it 5 years or seven? I never remember. Eight? Okay. Every 8 years, we have to do a whole new comprehensive plan update. It's almost funny because the legislature argues about the term every time. And it never falls out when the census comes out, which you would think makes sense. But we have to gear up for another major comprehensive plan update. Under the current comprehensive plan, we had to provide a mechanism for the city to grow up to 55,000 people. Being able to handle growth in a comprehensive and well-managed way is a criteria for the Growth Management Act. So we will need to be working on that effort, starting working on that effort. We've heard that the legislature is going to reconsider opening up the sales tax incentive for annexations. AWC is having a major push for that. If that happens, I mean, I've thought annexations are going to be a big part of our future in any regard, but if that program reopens up, we ought to probably take a look at advancing when we're going to be taking a look at really pulling off major annexations. Working with the mayor to develop a sustainable plan for supporting the work of the Human Services Diversity Commissions, this is in play as we speak. The South Lynnwood Plan has been making great progress. That's a joint effort of several departments, but most specifically Todd and his staff and Lynn Sordell and Sarah and Park staff. And they've had some good work done and they want to wrap that up. Alderwood Mall East expansion is going to be hitting the ground in big time, and we suspect other things are going to happen. But this is the replacement of the Sears building with mixed-use development and pads on the outside. We continue to work with Lynnwood Place developer. In fact, he was in our office on Friday afternoon. We're going to be bringing some things forward to the council on that. And at some point, and this is something David and I have discussed a lot, we really need to plan for a major update to the city center plan. City center plan was originally done, I think, in 2005, 2004. We did a major update, a fairly significant update in 2012. And that's when we adopted the development standards, and it benefited from all the studies, the traffic studies, the utility studies that we had done. With the work that we're doing now with some major developers, most specifically Merlone Guyer and what they're talking about, we realize we're going to probably be up pushing the limits, if you will, of the upper limit of what City Center and the EIS were designed for. Yet there's more development capacity there. And the boundaries may warrant another look. So it's something that we think we're going to have to tackle in the next few years. It's not immediately imminent, and we didn't ask for money to do it for this time, but it will require a new EIS and planned action ordinance. Community development budget summary. There is an increase year over year, fairly modest. Most of it was, you know, it's the usual increases in staffing. We have more, a little more money set aside for sending our plans out for plan reviews. And actually, on the plan review front, what the finance director and the mayor have been doing with us is we're there to facilitate new development coming in. So we don't want to turn the spigot off and say, okay, well, we ran out of money to send the plans out, so maybe we'll get a chance to look at your plans in 3 or 4 months. So because it's generating so much in permit fees, we have standing contracts with the consultants that are doing the work. And when we run out of professional services money to do that, the finance director has come back to the council and basically revolved around some of the permit fee money and put it back in our budget. That was done, I think, earlier this summer. It may need to be done, I'm not quite sure yet, before the end of the year. We just got some more statements from some of the contractors. The budget changes. I don't, you know, again, across the scheme of things, it's not particularly, I don't think it's particularly significant. I mean, we move things around to target them a little bit better, but there's modest increases. We also have to, all of us have had to absorb some shared costs. That's costs that used to be picked up, for example, by IT, have now been pushed down to the department, so that's in there a little bit too. If there's any specific questions on that, I'll try to answer that. We have been at 19 positions, and until we know what the analysis of DBS operations concludes, we're still at 19. And again, when I came here in 2006, I had 21. And that's community development. Now, fire prevention services is now the fire marshal's office, which is part of the DBS operation, and community development is responsible for managing their contract. I'd have to say that, again, Kevin Zweber and his folks have made tremendous progress. They've been great to work with in so many ways. We've made progress in areas that we only dreamed of previously. I think our customers are benefiting from that. We now have, we don't have to explain why we're different so often. And, you know, I've been in a number of meetings with Kevin where he tries to figure out a way to work through problems instead of just saying, well, you know, this is Lynnwood and we require X. So it's been pleasant. The RFA, Fire Marshal's Office, is a contract service that the city pays for. We don't actually have, Sonia, we haven't seen the final budget request from them. They're working on a labor agreement, and that's the only thing that will tinker with the outlay of costs for the Fire Marshal's Office. And I don't think they have a settlement yet, so we're waiting on that. Kevin put this together in terms of the highlights, of course, voter approval of the fire authority, co-located in the DBS. Again, the Title IX amendment, creating consistency with South Snohomish County, that I can't understate how important that was. It really put us in a position where we're not alienating our customers coming in the door, where they would come up with plans and say, well, this I want to build the same plan I built in Redmond. Well, so what, you know? But now we do have consistency, and it's immensely helpful. And again, Kevin, with the fee analysis, he rewrote and greatly simplified his fees, as we did too in community development, which we needed to do for the going on for the online permitting. But he used the fee structure to come up with the, he's got three tiers of fees. The over-the-counter, which is five devices or less, no plan review, just issue the thing. And I think it's 6 to 25, which requires a review, but it's quick. And potentially something we can do on an over-the-counter Tuesday or within a day or two. And then the larger projects require the standard review, which is take home the roll of plans and work through that. It's, again, been a great help. And he's working on the customer relationships that his staff are giving. Again, the relationship with Kevin and the folks has been, I can't say enough good things about it. what he wants to tackle in 1920, he continues to work with us on implementing the procedures and process improvements. His staff, Jen Lee on David's staff has been really our point person on implementing, rolling out, working with IT on all these new process and technological improvements. Kevin has, his staff has a presence on the working committee on that, as does mine, as does Arnold Kay and Public Works. He is trying to come up with ways to implement, to reduce the amount of time that it takes to get plans together. This is something our fire department knew for a long time, but Kevin's actually got to deal with it, is that we're getting high-rise development. That requires different training. It requires different expectations and knowledge on plan reviews. And I think that was the significant stuff that he was looking to do. His budget in there, again, it's based on the current allocation for the RFA. No, it's not? Oh, good. So maybe it's not going to increase when they settle their contract. Cross your fingers. Kevin's, he's moved some of his staff around. He's hiring some staff. And so he's covering a lot of bases right now. But, again, the service we've been getting is pretty good. Fire budget changes, well, it looks like we're saving a ton of money going with the RFA. And it's true. And that's fire prevention. And I think that's it.
Thank you. Council? Questions, comments? Councilmember Hurst? Okay.
I was curious on the when you talked about the implementing a rental housing business license inspection program, is that within your budget that's presented?
It doesn't cost anything. Well, I mean, I've already written the ordinance twice before, so I got to dust off my past notes. But in terms, I mean, a business license costs what a business license costs. Mm-hmm. And the periodic inspections, again, the way the state has it, they can either outsource it. You know, we can define who's an acceptable outsourcing firm, or they can pay us, they can take out a permit and do it. So, and if we take out a permit, it'll cover our cost.
Okay, great. That chart, or the slide that had the cost increase, or the... That, nope. One more. That one. So I see there's a South Lynnwood study. So we're doing another study, because I thought the last budget we talked about putting in $150,000 and that it was going to be studied within house. So now, what is this study for?
So there, if you recall, the South Lynnwood was broken up into two phases. So the first phase was the staff initiated outreach portion of it. So we did a lot of community engagement, trust building, working with citizens, and that was comprised of a lot of departments, community development, parks, public works, probably missing a couple others, economic development. Yeah. But the first phase was to really get out there and tell them that we are looking at how to improve this neighborhood, which is one of our most challenging neighborhoods from a variety of reasons. The second phase, which was presented, was to do a first of what we call sub-area plans, and it's to look at it more in depth in terms of how are we going to do neighborhood-type planning or further analysis of land use issues, housing issues, social issues, all that kind of stuff. And so our goal in this phase is to hire a consultant that would assist staff in doing a lot of the groundwork or legwork and developing that sub-area analysis plan. And so that's the majority of that funding for that study is to pay for the consultant to develop and do the public outreach. We're going to try something a little different rather than doing your typical, here's a meeting at 6 p.m. and come and join us, because that clearly hasn't worked. We're guilty of that as planners, of doing that forever. And you know, when you get three people showing up in a neighborhood, that just clearly isn't reaching people. And we've heard from the Planning Commission too loud and clear that we need to do things differently. So our goal is to use that money with a consultant, and also using a new outreach tools that will, if successful in this South Lynnwood, we can use it in all other areas of the city's outreach mechanisms. And so we'll that's our goal for South Lynnwood. And if this proves to be successful, this will be a model for then tackling other areas of the city that we'd like to emulate as we move along.
Okay, great. Now, on the not so small $500,000 for DBS efficiency staffing, so is there a study going on right now as far as staff efficiency, or
do you want to give the
about a year ago today, the mayor kicked off a project to take a fairly comprehensive view of all of the services we provide to developers and other people who use the services of the city that Paul's department heads up, and so we began that a year ago. Focus on bringing on two consultants. Both consultants looked at different aspects of our operations and customer service delivery. Mm-hmm. That study, the second study, is ongoing on now, and we're hoping to get a report and recommendations before you go on break.
Okay, yeah.
And the results of that study, the conclusions and recommendations from that study will help the mayor and the executive leadership team determine how best to utilize that $500,000.
And it may not just be a community development, it may be another staff at DBS. So we're looking at today's environment, where we're going to be in 5-10 years, what's the skill gap that we have in our current staffing as we move into, as you've eloquently heard from this group, all the progress that they've made in being more efficient and over-the-counter permitting, and there's more of that to come. So do we need staff that are proficient in using the technology, for example? And I just need to get that environmental study from this from Larry Bowman, the last one, and we'll see where we go.
So we're thinking that $500,000 would be for additional staffing?
Could be.
Is that we're thinking of?
Or it could be for some new technology or to keep us efficient. It's a placeholder, and maybe they're just perfect as they are.
I'm trying to hold my tongue on that one, just because. I mean, the honest opinion is that, anecdotally, I've heard, Lynnwood is a tough place to for contractors to come in too. And it just seems like in this past year or so, it's no longer anecdotal, but it seems to be a fact. I mean, I've gotten involved in a couple of problems with inspectors and owners, and maybe you're addressing that through the new system of, you know, making sure you're communicating with the owners. You know, and you look at Embassy Suites, and that remodel took 2 or 3 years, and we would go in there, and they'd always say, well, it's the city inspectors that are, you know. So I just hope we're just not throwing money into trying to solve something with a bunch of money that maybe these studies will tell us exactly where we can be a little more efficient. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor. Thank you, for Paul, for presenting both, and for your staff for being here with you. Just a quick question on the performance measures, the DBS survey inspection services overall rating with a target of 6. Is that 6 out of 6, or is that 6 out of 10? Like, what's the rating scale that we're targeting there? So is
what page are you on?
Oh, I'm sorry. It's
so Kathy can find
3.46 as an example. I'm just looking at what program is this?
Numbers,
sorry.
Numbers.
This is the Permits, Inspections, and Code Enforcement Services Program, starting on page 3.43, but the performance measures on 3.46. And it's one of the programs that has that performance measure of having a design survey rating.
Yeah, and to be honest, I don't remember the scale. This goes back to when Mary was working.
Okay, so it's 6 out of 7.
Okay. Okay, and okay. This is the survey that we've been doing when we have 100 respondents for the last 5 years or so?
Yeah. Gotcha. Maybe just stating that in there that we're targeting 6 out of 7, just so, I mean, I originally am looking at that, I'm going, are we only trying to get 6 out of 10? 6 seemed like such an arbitrary number. So anyway, maybe that would be helpful, because that seems like a good goal, getting 6 out of 7. But yeah. Otherwise, you covered all my questions in your presentation. It was very thorough. So thank you.
Thank you. Other questions, comments, counsel? All right. Good job. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. You guys are the closers. Good job. All right, counsel. Sonia and... Oh, a few words from our budget leads, just in closing for the... Since we're done with our department... presentations now.
Okay, you've just listened to the very last departmental budget presentation, and I congratulate you for spending every Monday evening here since October 8th listening to budget presentations from the departments. I thought they all did a great job. So now the next step is to have a public hearing, which is scheduled for next Tuesday, November 13th. At that time, I would encourage anyone who has requests for special items or that you bring them then, if you have any requests for changes. And if you do have a request for additional expenditures, you would need to identify where the revenues are going to come, or a reduction of expenditure somewhere else to pay for that. Because currently we have a balanced budget, and there is a little bit of money left over after our reserve requirements are met, but not much and not ongoing. So I also want to know if you have any questions for any of the departments, that they would need to come back and address any answers that they might have with your questions. So, of course, you can ask questions this evening. It's all about the budget. And then we would make sure and follow up with you. We also have the November 13th meeting to review any discussion you might have about your budget presentations that you've seen and any changes you might wish to make.
You have a question, Councilmember Hurst?
This is probably pretty easy. In the General Government Capital Improvement Fund, where we talked about that $4 million loan.
Yes.
Where's that reflected?
I'll explain that to you. So that is a placeholder for the purchase of a possible homeless area, homeless center. And how that would be financed would be a loan from a bank, probably 10 years or 15-year loan from a bank. And it would be paid back, the debt service would be paid back by the REIT funds. So you will see the REIT funds transfer, each of those REIT funds, $500,000 a year to pay for the payback of the loan. Yeah, it's budgeted
in REIT.
That's
an outside loan. It's not something we're taking.
No, it would be an outside loan. Okay. Interest rates are pretty good for municipal loans, but they don't go for 30 years like you would see in a mortgage. They go 10 years. Normally, you get the best rate for 10 years. Yeah.
And we're working on fundraising, so you're not having to do $4 million. Yes, Corbett?
If I can add, at the conclusion of the public hearing, you will have heard from staff and you will have heard from the public, and you will be beginning your deliberations yourself on the budget. This is important because we at this stage aren't clear on how many meetings the council is going to want to devote to deliberating. We have tentative meetings scheduled between now and what we anticipate would be final action on the 26th. At a minimum, we do need to make final action on the property tax for 2019. That's a pretty hard deadline right there. But anyway, there are additional meeting times where you could meet if necessary, but again, we don't know what your preferences are and would be looking to you on the 13th to give us some guidance on that as well.
Maybe that's something council leadership can take a poll on as you're planning the agendas. You can add in as necessary or take away as necessary.
It's true. Do we have any other comments, questions? Because we're getting close to time.
Just a process comment. I would ask that the council leadership consider the upcoming TBD board meeting as part of that, so that we're, because part of that discussion was there's still a motion hanging out there for tab fees. So I think it would be prudent to make sure that we do anything we're planning to schedule for budget post-TBD board meeting, just so that we're dotting I's and crossing T's. That would be my only process comment.
Good one. All right, anything else?
Yes, I have two quick comments. Okay. One has to do, this is a completely different subject. This has to do with our council summit on Saturday, February 9th. We're planning to hold that at the Alderwood Community Church Fireside Room. And basically, we need to decide whether we want to start at 8:30 or 9 and end at noon or 1. So something to keep in mind. I don't need that right now, but as soon as possible, if you can just let Beth know what your preference is, if you have one. And then the AWC Health Plan open enrollment is tomorrow from 1:30 to 3 or 3:30 to 5. And then again, Tuesday, November 13th. 10 to noon or 1 to 3. Okay. So then I move that we extend the meeting until we are finished with item J.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No, J.
Okay, J.
Anyway, so starting at 8:30 or 9 o'clock. I'll tell you, my preference was 9 o'clock. You think 8:30? All right.
I'm flexible. So.
Two nines and two 8:30s and three flexibles. Someone needs to be a tiebreaker.
If we do 8:30, then we get to leave earlier? No. Or it goes, what's the quitting time?
Or do we have noon decided or that one. Yet? That was the other thing, is noon or one.
8:30 is fine for me.
All right, so 9 o'clock on the... No, I'm just kidding. All right, so looks like an 8:30 start time and ending at noon or 1. Okay, 1 o'clock.
I mean, there's also going to be potentially a different president at that time, too, making the agenda as well. So
it could, that's true.
It could be.
Could be what?
I'm just saying that we take the later time just to reserve it. If we want to go less, we can still go less.
Yeah. Okay, so 7:30 to 3.
Killing me.
8:30 to 1. Yeah.
All right.
That's all that I have, Your Honor.
Any other council comments? Motion to adjourn?
Second.
No. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.